This is the age of planetary exploration, when our ships have begun to sail the heavens. In those heavens, there are some worlds much like hell. Our planet is, in comparison, much like a heaven. But the gates of heaven and hell are adjacent and unmarked. The Earth is a lovely and more or less placid place. Things change, but slowly. You can lead a full life and never encounter anything in the way of a natural catastrophe more violent than a storm. And so we become complacent, relaxed, unconcerned. But in the history of the solar system, and even in human history, there are clear records of extraordinary and devastating catastrophes. We humans have now achieved the dubious distinction of being able to make our own major catastrophes, both intentional and inadvertent. On the landscapes of other planets, where the records of the past are better preserved, there is abundant evidence of major catastrophes. It's all a matter of time scale. An event which is improbable in 100 years may be inevitable in 100 million. But even on the Earth, in this century, there have been bizarre natural events.
This temperature record for temperatures on this planet is a central England temperature record, which goes back to the mid-1600s. And the first of the, oh, sorry, the latest in 16th, in the 17th century, the latest warming cycle in the 17th century going into the 18th century was faster and greater than the latest warming, which finished in 1995. And Justin Bieber wasn't flying his private jet around in the 1600s. That's the first thing. The second thing was we've had a pause in this so-called warming for now 21 years. Depends how you measure it, 21 years. And I'm absolutely stunned that someone who is inspired by Richard Feynman, a fantastic scientist who believes in empirical evidence, is quoting consensus.
Can I just say, I brought the graph, right? I mean, can you just... Where the pause is, the pause that's often quoted, if you take this point here, which is about 1997, I think, and you ignore 2015, 2016, you can choose that point and you can draw a slightly straighter trend line on there. But that's a misunderstanding. The question is, does that rise? And also, secondly, I'd brought another graph because I heard it. Is it correlated with that, which is the graph that shows the CO2 emissions, the CO2 in parts per million in the atmosphere? And you see that peak there, where it goes flying up. So the question essentially is, first of all, are those two things correlated? And secondly, do we understand the physical mechanisms? And we understood those since the 19th century.
Can you go back to the middle of the graph? I can give you a lesson if you want. Can you go back to the middle of the graph there?
Yeah.
The
that graph.
Yeah, the peak in the middle?
Yep.
What year is that?
That's about 1941.
Yeah, 1930s and 40s were warmer than the current decades. What's the data source?
Well, not exactly.
No, the original records are. The original records are far warmer. But the other thing that tells me that graph has got something wrong with it is that 1998 was about the same as 2015-16.
Okay, I was going to pause here. So you're hearing.
It was an El Nino year.
Both were El Nino years. Malcolm, just one second.
You're hearing the interpretation of a highly qualified scientist, and you're just saying I don't believe it. Is that right?
I'm saying two things. First of all, that the data has been corrupted, and we know that the 1930s were warmer than today.
Yeah. Corrupted? What do you mean, corrupted?
Been manipulated and by NASA, NASA.
The people
say,
this is quite serious.
No, I'm going to just ask the audience, just hang on. We've actually got to hear what's being said here. So it's all very well to laugh, but we want to hear what's being said.
Steve Goddard, he has shown the NASA figures, and the graph was originally showing that 1930s were warmer than recent decades, and that is correct. And people have recognized that for many, many years. And in the recent years, they've been reversed so that the 1930s were reduced in temperature and the later periods were inflated in temperature. That's a fact. Now, the Bureau of Meteorology is exactly the same. And Greg Hunt squashed an investigation of the Bureau of Meteorology earlier this year.
Okay, all right, Greg Hunt.
Can I just check you one thing? NASA. Now, NASA,
yes.
The people that landed men on the moon.
I
should just ask, actually, you believe we landed men on the moon.
But, see the little trick there?
No.
It's questioning whether or not I believe that I'm a moon skeptic. Now,
are you?
No, I'm not.
Oh, right. But it's a serious accusation. The idea that NASA and presumably, I should say to people, by the way, that the Australian Academy of Science have done a brilliant, you can never get any sense on programs like this, they're adversarial and things, but this, the Science of Climate Change, the Australian Academy of Sciences report is superb. I brought it because I'm going to come and give it to you in a minute so you can have a read. But that's very good if you want to see this. But the point is that the accusation that NASA, pretty all the Australian, the Met Office in the UK, everybody is collaborating to manipulate global temperature data.
Are you saying they're collaborating?
Well, they've all manipulated it in the same way and accidentally got to the same answer. Is that what you're saying?
NASA was led by James Hansen.
This planet. Were the unmanned spacecraft of the Soviet Venera series. In our spaceship of the imagination, we retrace their course. From a distance, our sister planet seems serene and peaceful, its clouds motionless. These clouds are near the top of a great ocean of air, about 100 kilometers thick, composed mainly of carbon dioxide. There's some nitrogen, a little water vapor, and other gases, but only the merest trace of hydrocarbon. And the clouds turn out to be not water, but a concentrated solution of sulfuric acid. Even in the high clouds, Venus is a thoroughly nasty place. The clouds are stained yellow by sulfur. There are great lightning storms. As we descend, there are increasing amounts of the noxious gas, sulfur dioxide. The pressures become so high that early Venera spacecraft were crushed like old tin cans by the weight of the surrounding atmosphere. Beneath the clouds, in the dense, clear air, it's about as bright as on an overcast day on Earth. But the atmosphere is so thick that the ground seems to ripple and distort. The atmospheric pressure down here is 90 times that on Earth. The temperature is 380 degrees centigrade, 900 Fahrenheit, hotter than the hottest household oven. This is a world marked by searing heat, crushing pressures, sulfurous gases, and a desolate, reddish landscape, far from the balmy paradise imagined by some early scientists. Venus is the one place in the solar system most like hell. But today, as in ancient tradition, there are travelers who will dare a visit to the underworld. Venera 9 was the first spacecraft in human history to return a photograph from the surface of Venus. It found the rocks curiously eroded, perhaps by the corrosive gases, perhaps because the temperature is so high that the rocks are partly molten and sluggishly flow. The Soviet Venera spacecraft, their electronics long ago fried, are slowly corroding on the surface of Venus. They are the first spaceships from Earth ever to land on another planet. The reason Venus is like hell seems to be what's called the greenhouse effect. Ordinary visible sunlight penetrates the clouds and heats the surface, but the dense atmosphere blankets the surface and prevents it from cooling off to space. An atmosphere 90 times as dense as ours, made of carbon dioxide, water vapor, and other gases, lets in visible light from the sun, but will not let out the infrared light radiated by the surface. So the temperature rises until the infrared radiation trickling out to space just balances the sunlight reaching the surface. The greenhouse effect can make an Earth-like world into a planetary inferno. In this cauldron, there is not likely to be anything alive, even creatures very different from us. Organic and other conceivable biological molecules would simply fall to pieces. The hell of Venus is in stark contrast with the comparative heaven of its neighboring world, our little planetary home, the Earth. Here, the atmosphere is 90 times thinner. Here, the carbon dioxide and water vapor make a modest greenhouse effect, which heats the ground above the freezing point of water. Without it, our oceans would be frozen solid. A little greenhouse effect is a good thing. But Venus is an ominous reminder that on a world rather like the Earth, things can go wrong. There is no guarantee that our planet will always be so hospitable. To maintain this clement world, we must understand it and appreciate it. The Earth is a place to our eyes more beautiful than any other that we know. But this beauty has been sculpted by change. Gentle, almost indetectable change, and sudden, violent change. Slow, uniform processes, unheralded events, the sting of a sand grain, the fall of a drop of water, can over the ages totally rework the landscape. Exceptional events that will not recur in a lifetime also make major changes.
insignificant and the extraordinary are the architects of the natural world. Grasslands makes the surface of the Earth brighter. It reflects more sunlight back to space and cools our planet. After we discovered fire, we began to incinerate forests intentionally to clear the land by a process called slash and burn agriculture. And today, forests and grasslands are being destroyed frivolously, carelessly, by humans who are heedless of the beauty of our cousins, the trees, and ignorant of the possible climatic catastrophes which large-scale burning of forests may bring. The indiscriminate destruction of vegetation may alter the global climate in ways that no scientist can yet predict. It has already deadened large patches of the Earth's life-supporting skin. And yet, we ravage the Earth at an accelerated pace, as if it belonged to this one generation, as if it were ours to do with as we please. The Earth has mechanisms to cleanse itself, to neutralize the toxic substances in its system. But these mechanisms work only up to a point. Beyond some critical threshold, they break down. The damage becomes irreversible. If we ruin the Earth, there is no place else to go. This is not a disposable world, and we are not yet able to re-engineer other planets. Desert on Earth is far more hospitable than any place on Mars. The bright sandy surface and dusty atmosphere of Mars reflect enough sunlight back to space to cool the planet, freezing out all its water, locking it in a perpetual ice age. At the same time, we are releasing vast quantities of carbon dioxide, increasing the greenhouse effect. The Earth need not resemble Venus very closely for it to become barren and lifeless. It may not take much to destabilize the Earth's climate, to convert this heaven, our only home in the cosmos, into a kind of hell. The study of the global climate, the sun's influence, the comparison of the Earth with other worlds, these are subjects in their earliest stages of development. They are funded poorly and grudgingly. And meanwhile, we continue to load the Earth's atmosphere with materials about whose long-term influence we are almost entirely ignorant. there are worlds that began with as much apparent promise as Earth, but something went wrong. Knowing that worlds can die alerts us to our danger. If a visitor arrived from another world, what account would we give of our stewardship of the planet Earth?
I don't agree with all this story about climate change at all. And there has been patterns of climate change going back over the years before there, indeed there was ever a combustible engine working or put in play in this country or in any other country. Because if we go back to the 11th and the 12th centuries, this country was roasted out of it. And in the 13th, the 15th and the 16th centuries, we were drowned out of it. In the 1740s, we had a famine that we lost over 3 million people because of 2 years of bad weather. The records will prove that, Eamon Ryan. And I say to you, we lost over 3 million at that time. We didn't have any combustible engine or anything like it at that time. And you're talking about cattle and suckler cows. There weren't a fraction of the cows in Ireland that time. That's there, no. And what I'm saying to you is, patterns of climate change took place regarding, and mankind, I don't believe, had any hand actor part in it. It's something that happened. If we go back farther than that, we had the Ice Age, and when the whole country was covered in ice. And if you come along to the 1860s to the 1880s, this country was drowned out of it. And there was one year, particular year, the sun didn't shine at all at all. I believe that God above is in charge of the weather, and that we here can't do anything about it.
Can you go about trying to answer the question?
The models that the IPCC uses are unvalidated and erroneous and have already been proven hopelessly wrong. And that's a fact.
How would you go about answering the question?
You answer the question by making projections based on models, providing the models are validated and have been proven to be accurate. And the models have already been proven to be inaccurate, and the IPCC has recognized that and admitted it. Now, what we need to do is look at the empirical data, and the empirical data says quite categorically that the levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere are a result of temperature changes.
Subtle. Since this series was first broadcast, the dangers of the increasing greenhouse effect have become much more clear. We burn fossil fuels like coal and gas and petroleum, putting more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere and thereby heating the Earth. The hellish conditions on Venus are a reminder that this is serious business. Computer models that successfully explain the climates of other planets predict the deaths of forests, parched croplands, the flooding of coastal cities, environmental refugees, widespread disasters in the next century, unless we change our ways. What do we have to do? Four things. One, much more efficient use of fossil fuels. Why not cars that get 70 miles a gallon instead of 25? Two, research and development on safe alternative energy sources, especially solar power. Three, reforestation on a grand scale. And four, helping to bring the billion poorest people on the planet to self-sufficiency, which is the key step in curbing world population growth. Every one of these steps makes sense apart from greenhouse warming. Now, no one has proposed that the trouble with Venus is that there once was Venusians who drove fuel-inefficient cars. But our nearest neighbor, nevertheless, is a stark warning on the possible fate of an Earth-like world. and the world impoverishes itself by spending $1 trillion a year on preparations for war, and by employing perhaps half the scientists and high technologists on the planet in military endeavors. How would we explain all this to a dispassionate extraterrestrial observer? What account would we give of our stewardship of the planet Earth? We have heard the rationales offered by the superpowers. We know who speaks for the nations. But who speaks for the human species? Who speaks for Earth? From an extraterrestrial perspective, our global civilization is clearly on the edge of failure. The most important task it faces, preserving the lives and well-being of its citizens and the future habitability of the planet. But if we're willing to live with the growing likelihood of climatic catastrophes, we'll also be willing to explore vigorously every possible means to prevent a climatic catastrophe. We consider in every nation major changes in the traditional ways of doing things, a fundamental restructuring of economic, political, social, and religious institutions. We've reached a point where there can be no more special interests or special cases. Climatic catastrophes threaten every person on the earth. Fundamental changes in society are sometimes labeled impractical or contrary to human nature, as if climatic catastrophes were practical, or as if there were only one human nature. But fundamental changes can clearly be made. We're surrounded by them. In the last 2 centuries, abject slavery, which was with us for thousands of years, has almost entirely been eliminated in a stirring worldwide revolution. Women, systematically mistreated for millennia, are gradually gaining the political and economic power traditionally denied. And some wars of aggression have recently been stopped or curtailed because of a revulsion felt by the people in the aggressor nations. The old appeals to racial, sexual, religious chauvinism and to rabid nationalist fervor are beginning not to work. A new consciousness is developing which sees the Earth as a single organism and recognizes that an organism at war with itself is doomed. We are one planet.